just thank you, Lord. We worship you, Father. We invite you, Holy Spirit. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. The Son of God was slain in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away. His perfect love cannot be
sing, hallelujah. We sing, hallelujah.
because he's alive and man.
Yes, he is.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, cover up my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. You're taking me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock. Now I know, well, I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end.
Jesus, lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. Take me from the miry clay. Set my feet upon the rock. Now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end.
Jesus, you're the lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. Taking me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock. Now I know. Well, I love you. And I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end.
Jesus, Jesus, I will never let you go. Take me from my place. Set my feet upon the rock. Now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you.
Lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You're taking me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon the rock. Now I know that I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you.
Jesus, I will never let you go.
Take me
from the very clay. Set my feet upon the rock. Now I know I love you. I need you. For my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very.
Come on, let's sing it to him.
Jesus, lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. Take me from the miry clay. Set my feet upon the rock. Now I know I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you to the very end.
Come on, let's worship him.
I will worship you until the very end. worship you. I will worship you until the very end. One more time. I will worship you. I will worship you. I will worship you until the very end.
Refuge, shelter, awesome God. all leads back to you, Jesus. All leads back to you. All leads back to you. First and the last, you will never change. And from here now on, God, all I need is you. First and the last, you will never change. Hero, Savior, Holy One, refuge, shelter, awesome God. All leads back to you, Jesus. All leads back to you. All leads back to you. Everybody, first and last. And first and the last, and you will never change. And from here now on, God, all I need is you. And first and the last, you will never change. And from here now on, God, all I need is you. All I need is you, Jesus. Yes, it is. All I need is you. All I need is you. All I need is you, Jesus. All I need is you. All I need is you. And first and the last, you will never change. From here now on, God, all I need is you. First and the last, you will never change. And from here now on, God, all I need is you.
Give it up for Pastor Bob.
Look to the sky, he's coming soon.
be riding a white horse when he comes to take us home. Look to the sky, look to the sky. We're King of Kings. As he breaks the eastern sky, the dead in Christ shall rise. As we meet our Savior Christ, look to the sky. Look to the sky,
he's coming soon.
For he
is the great I Am. Look to the sky, he's coming soon. Look to the sky. Holy,
everything, and I will adore you. No music, just your voices tonight. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand tonight. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Father, for just this music, Father, that was sung to you, Father God. We worship you. We give you praise and glory, Father God. We thank you for the service that's going to continue, Father God, and for the minister that's going to minister in word tonight, Lord. We just give you the honor, the glory, and the praise in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And we all say, amen.
Amen.
Got it. Hey, Steve, can you get the house lights? The house lights. The house lights. Please, thank you. It's starting to get a little dark. Hopefully, I don't drop my iPad. This iPad, it took... Has anybody ever put an iPad through a concrete test? If I ever find anybody that survives one, let me know. By the way, I won in golf today. A lot of echo. Okay. Let me pull up here. Is that better? No. What's that? Yeah. Oh, Steve, you got special effects on this thing?
Yeah. Top 1, 2, 3, 4, thank you, Jesus. Gotta get better at it again. Let's try a little bit. Is that what you're saying? He watched this knucklehead call him down to the Total in the middle of January in 2012 and wondering what I was doing. And I said, we get there and we're going to throw him. I said, by the way, we're starting to worship him. So he was the first one that we did. So thanks for watching. It's a good one. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Lord, stand up. Linda came to us. Standing there at the soundboard is Pastor Wayne Wilkins. He's been filling in for us on bass, extremely anointed musician. Next is Brother Kelly Ward. He has an extra ministry too, Music from the Heart Ministries. He is an anointed musician, awesome singer. You ask him to play, he don't care where it's at. Say, I want you to go down and play on the corner of Broadway and Barron, and he's there. Which of yours is there? Probably a poor choice of streets. Sherman, stand up, brother. Sherman has been with us from the beginning. He's played awesome drummer. Cynthia, Cynthia Sherman's wife. She's our lead singer, and as you notice, she's got a bun in the oven, but not just one. How many you got, Cynthia?
Two.
And that's a neat story. One of these times during Friday Night Lights, we are going to have you give up and give your total testimony. We've heard Sherman's. We need to hear yours as well. So. Our sound guy, Steve Tennant. Steve's been with us for about 8-9 months now, I think. Just doing an awesome job. Pastor Bob, I'm going to have you stand up because anybody that stands up on stage, you're a part of 9-9 the worship band. Our guest. Tomorrow night, we've got this gentleman right here. And I tell you what, he's going to be bringing a really cool message. I have all the confidence in the world. So if you all want to turn your Bibles, let's take a guess. Matthew 4 and verse 19. Then he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you that it goes forth with revelation knowledge, with understanding. Lord, we just ask that you penetrate each and every heart that's in this auditorium this evening, Lord God. Lord, that it just goes forth, and Lord, that it's life-changing, Lord God, that it changes life, that it transforms people, Lord God, that it gets them to a new motivation, Lord God, and that they come out of this place with a new enthusiasm for you, Father God, to take forth and take charge of their walk with you, Father God, to make you number one in Jesus' mighty name. Everyone said, amen. I had a neat topic. Okay. Was it Tuesday night? We were over at Rupert's. And I'm not afraid to do some plagiarism, so I took what he told me, and I ran with it. So, and I just take that as a message from the Holy Spirit. We're going to continue. I'm going to start. We're going to stay right here in Matthew 4. And we're going to move up to verse 18. We're going to actually go right back through it, down to 22. And it says, "And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon, called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net to the sea, for they were fishermen. Then he said to them, 'Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.' They immediately left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father. Mending their nets, he called them, and immediately they left their boats and their father and followed him." I want to go into a little bit. We're going to start off. I'm going to go into the actual word "follow." What does the word "follow" mean? I pulled up a couple of definitions. The first one is to go, proceed, or to come after. That's your pretty much a typical. You know, somebody leaves, you follow after them, you follow after them. The next one was really neat. I pulled this out of Merriam-Webster's dictionary. It said, to engage in as a calling or a way of life, the second part. To pursue. And I sat there and I was like, whoa, to pursue? Just think for a minute. Engage in a calling. Not just say, oh, I've got a calling, engage in it. I mean, you grab a hold of it and you run with it. Engage. When Jesus was talking with the four fishermen, eventually all four of those men became his disciples. And he was pretty short and to the point. I mean, he basically said, let's go. He said, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. He asked them to engage in a call. I mean, it was just instantaneous, like, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. Okay, I'm gone.
I'm going with this guy. The question we need to ask, are we engaged in the calling that we are asked from God? Or are we just at a lackadaisical? This is going to be a good message, but there may be some tough parts too. There's going to be some tough love in here tonight. I'm not here to be politically correct. I'm here to tell you what the Word of God's, you know, what God's telling me. So are we pursuing God's plan for our life, or are we just sitting and waiting for something to happen? I can tell you right now, if you're just waiting for something to happen in your life, thinking that God's going to have something fall down from the ground, it ain't going to happen. I'm sorry. You know, I have seen people, I myself have done that. Say, well, I'm just waiting for God to make this move. And you sit and wait, wait, wait. God wants you to be moving while things are going on. He don't want you just to sit there and say, well, I'm going to wait, or I'm not going to do this because this is not my calling. You know, he don't want you to just sit there and say, well, you know, those guys over there need prayer, but that's not my calling. I operate in the gift of prophecy, so I can't do it. No, you need to go over and pray, whatever's going on in the moment. You know, you just can't sit around. And I'll tell you what, you know, and even if you mess up on things, and I mean, I've messed up on the work I've done for the Lord. I've made mistakes, but, you know, so many times, even in our mistakes, if your heart is in the right place, He still rewards that. You know, I've done some silly things. I've done some things I thought maybe I wasn't listening to God the right way. You know, I left my work a couple years ago and thinking that was my calling, and for a while after a year I started beating myself up, well, maybe that isn't, but you know, there were some other things in play and maybe that was God's calling. But and that's a big thing that we do sometimes, we do beat ourselves up when we take that step and it doesn't go in the way that this thinks it's supposed to. A lot of times this gets in the way, you know. But you know, that may, and I look back at that time now and realize, well, maybe I needed to take that time off for refreshing and to get my life back in order. So anyway, back to the message. So I'm going to do a little kind of a drill here. Simon, get up. Bob, get up. Okay. Rex, I want you to stand right there. Tina, stand right here. Okay. Jan and your friend Sherry, I want you two to stand up with them, okay? All right. And Ron Price, come on up. I can start my joke. You know, I always say when somebody gets rebellious, I say, oh, it's pink belly time. Ron and Simon, stand right here. Okay, Simon, you're being prayed for. Okay, Ron, you're right behind him. Lay hands on him like you're holding him. Okay, all right. And I'm sitting here like this. I got to lay hands on him too. You two are. I want you four to line up this way. Okay, there we go. That's good right there. Tina, turn around like you guys are pointing there. I've seen this at an altar call a few times. And pastor's praying, and there's other people that are anointed working the altar. All of a sudden, there you don't know how long this guy's going to be. What you do, you look up, and Ron and me are looking around, and there's four people down there. What? No, we're supposed to be right here. What are we supposed to be doing? What? We should be right here. It's like, no, I'm an armor bearer. I'm supposed to be covering. No, at times you need to get up and go over and start praying and be over here. You've got to take that step out. Well, I've never done that before. Well, there's got to be a first time for everything. It just can't be, say, well, I've never done that before. I'm scared. Well, the first time I did it, I was scared. You know, there's a first time for everything. You guys can sit down now. Thank you. Thank you. Some water, there we go. I'm a salesman by trade, and which means this thing is my moneymaker. Not only to talk to you guys, and usually I'm a pretty quiet guy. What kind of laugh was that, Dina? No laughing. But I may. There was a time when I had to make that first step to be a salesman. I had to make that very first sales call. You know, same with Pastor Bob. He does the same thing I do. He sells oil field equipment. Different product, but, you know, a lot of times we talk to the same guys. Matter of fact, we walked into the office at the same time trying to call on the same guy. So, but you had your first sales call. You remember that day? Scary, wasn't it? It was very scary. But we have to get past that fear. That fear is a trick, a nasty trick from the enemy. That's what he wants you to do. The enemy wants to put you down and hold you back from what God's plan is. Oh, I'm afraid. Who cares? Make that step forward and do what God asks you to do. The same with Larry, you know. Larry, you remember your first job? You've talked about, you know, what you did, and you had to make that first step to what would you call your trade? A carpenter? Yeah. And probably that first time you did that, though, it was a little bit different. It was probably scary, right? Yeah. That, you know, we all been to that one. You know, I'm talking about our professional life, but, you know, that can go in parallel with what our other job is and our most important job, and that's spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm actually not going off my sermon right now, so, which I have a tendency to do sometimes nowadays, so. But anyway, like I said, I've actually seen this happen, you know. Here we go. Praise you, Jesus. You know, and if you ever see that happening, man, that's, and you say, well, why aren't the people praying for you? Well, maybe that's someone telling you the Holy Spirit telling you you need to get up and pray for those folks. Thank you, sir. Stepping forward, that's part of follow, that actually is part of following me. So. We talked about jobs. I'm also going to take a look, you know, we need to take a look at, one way to take a look at our callings is by medical fields. They're like, well, medical fields, where is Chris going on with medical fields? So we have ourselves, too many times we treat ourselves as specialists. Say, I'm a heart specialist. Only thing I do is I'm a heart surgeon. I'm only allowed to have surgery on hearts. I open these guys up and I repair the valves on the hearts and da 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 da. But what if the person, you know, what if you're the only doctor in town and somebody comes up and has the flu? Okay, are you going to tell them, well, I can't do that because I'm a heart specialist, so, you know, dude. Yeah, you're going to have to go 200 miles down the road and get the medication you need and the treatment you need. Or what's that specialist going to do? He's going to treat him. Yeah. He's going to treat him. And that's what we got to do. We got to step out of our box from being a heart specialist and realize at that moment you may be an ear and eye doctor over here. Or you may be an orthopedic surgeon or da 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 da. Same thing in your walk with Christ. Well, I'm an intercessor. Great. But this person's hungry. Well, I guess you're going to feed them tonight. Or, you know, this person needs their air conditioning repaired. Well, got to step into that. This person needs the valve off their propane tank on their grill pulled off. Jan's laughing at me because I did that this week. So I won't embarrass you anymore. That's it. I won't go into the whole detail. It took me 5 minutes to fix it. She couldn't do it for weeks. So, anyway, like I said, I had talked to Rupert on Tuesday and me and Kelly stopped by with him the other day. We, you know, we We had a great conversation, and that was an incredible day altogether. I'd like to talk about the first gentleman we talked to, but I'm not going to steal his thunder. I'm just believing that God's going to have us. He's going to be at a Friday Night Light soon. I just have all the belief in the world. I believe he's going to be at my father's house on Sunday, but his testimony is incredible. But Rupert made an analogy about ministry that I just found just, it was fascinating. And he had talked about some of the local ministries around. And what he had talked about was ministries, just about every ministry out there, there's a time when they have the ball. You know, when they have the ball, and it depends on what they do when the Lord gives them that ball. You know, so whether it's a football, that's why I need a football tonight. So, by the way, this, I guess, will be my football tonight. So, but what do they do when they have that ball? You know, are they just going to stand there, or are they going to do what Jesus asked them to do and to run with it? It all depends on what you do with that ball, whether you keep it or not. If you just stand there with that ball, you're going to eventually lose it. One of the parts, how many people here have seen Forrest Gump? You know, I think everybody on planet Earth has seen Forrest Gump at one time or another, but everybody remembers the part where, you know, he realizes that he can run really fast, and then I guess they're showing it as Bear Bryant. He runs across the field, and Bear Bryant sees him running across, and goes, man, that dude's fast. Well, shows him in the next scene, and he's at the stadium, and the guy, you know, they have the kickoff. The guy hands him the football, and Forrest is just standing there until somebody goes, run, dummy! And then all of a sudden he's running. He don't know what direction to go, and this guy points him this way, and then there's another guy who points him this way, and he goes back and forth until he finally makes the touchdown. He winds up wiping out a couple of cheerleaders and a couple of bandmates, but he was running. But he didn't do anything, and this is the key. He didn't do anything until somebody was there screaming at him, because he wasn't listening. You know, he wasn't paying attention at his practices on what to do. You know, that's the way I took it. You know, if Travis seen a player like that do that in the game, he's like, well, it looks like he really paid attention in practice. He sat there until another player just got to him and said, run, dummy. So that's the ministry that has the ball. They ain't going to do anything. They're reactionary. They just grab the ball and they're up. And then the enemy comes up to you. Then they react. And that's not what we should be doing. We shouldn't be sitting there waiting for something bad to happen and then react to it. You know, and that's basically what he did. He got scared. Somebody said, move, dummy, and he went, then he took off. Here's another analogy. How many know who Franco Harris is? Franco Harris was a running back for the Pittsburgh Steelers back in their glory days back in the 1970s. In 1972, there was a game they played in the playoffs against the Oakland Raiders. I think Pastor Bob even knows where I'm going with this. There was, I forgot who Terry Bradshaw was throwing the pass to. Do you remember? It was probably Lynn Schwann or one of those guys. Well, it hit him in the chest, hit the receiver in the chest, and it blasts back the other direction towards the scrimmage line. And who's there to catch the ball? It's Franco Harris. Nobody had to tell him, run, dummy. He grabbed the ball, and he darted, and I think he made a touchdown with that. Yeah, because they were down 7-6. They wound up winning 13-7 with, I think they had like 30 seconds left. That's how we need to be. It's like all of a sudden God comes up, hands you the ball, boom. Okay, God, I see what you're telling me. You go and do it. That is what Rupert was talking about. You know? So once you grab that ball, you run. The point here is that Franco Harris clearly knew what he wanted to do when he got the ball. He did not have to be told to run. Let's turn our Bibles over to 1 Corinthians. And we're going over to chapter 9. And we're going to start in verse 24. And this section is called Striving for a Crown. It says, "Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it, and everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we do it for an imperishable crown. Therefore, I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body, and I bring it into subjection, lest, when I've preached to others, I myself become disqualified." And I want you to look at the second half of verse 24. It says, "But one receives the prize. Run in such a way that you may obtain it." He says, so, you know, it's everything we do for God. It is a race, you know. But the good thing is, it's already won. We just got to go get it. We just have to go get it. And it says, and, you know, the world, they're making their run. The enemy is trying to trick you and getting in, and what he's going to get is a perishable crown. It's going away. He may get his jollies off for a few minutes, but it's gone. The race we're getting lasts forever. The crown we get is going to last forever. It doesn't go away. Matter of fact, we already have it. The minute you start working for the Lord, you've accepted that free gift of salvation. You already have an imperishable crown at that point. You have a prize. Now all you have to do is just start running the score up. You know, it was 1-0 when you got saved. And now all you have to do is say, okay, God, use me. What can we do? Boom, 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 boom. First inning, it's 20-0. You know, and that's how it should be. We don't have to wait till it's the bottom of the ninth and Kirk Gibson comes up to bat in the 1988 World Series and hits a home run to win the game. God wants us to run the score up right away, you know, and there's no mercy rule. So anyway. So sounds like to me that God wants us to run, to follow him and win. Who believes that here tonight? Amen. Amen. Doesn't sound like, oh, well, chalk this one up for the competition. Not good enough. He wants us to run like champions. He wants, because the war's already been won, you know. And, yeah, you know, I understand. We all have setbacks. I mean, we have our days. I mean, I've had our days. Ron seen me have one of my days a couple of years ago. By the way, I'm in front of everybody, I am truly sorry that I did that to you 2 years ago. Seriously. But, you know, I've had to do that a few times sitting from this pulpit this year. You know, if I ever offend anybody, man, I am so sorry when I do that. You know, because sometimes, even, you know, sometimes the flesh does get in the way. And, you know, sometimes this guy gets in the way, you know. And it's like, you know, you can't, it isn't like a rod and reel and you're fishing. You can't sit there and say a word or take an action and reel it back and you're safe. It goes out and it's, the line breaks and it's gone forever. And it hurts people. So if there's ever any time I do it, I'm sorry. If I've done it intentionally, I'm really sorry. But if I do it unintentionally, I'm still sorry. We'll get on with that side note. But anyway, you know, when we're doing this, you know, when we're doing the work, we're supposed to do it cheerfully, you know. And I've seen people do this, you know, and I know I'm trying to kind of being a critic tonight, but the one thing is I've made these mistakes, and I don't want people to make the same mistakes, you know. I don't want, I've seen people where they're, you know, they're trying to minister to people, and they're walking like this. Oh. I've actually seen people do that. You know, it's like, I'll find somebody to pray for me. You know, that's, you got to come with that cheerful face. I don't care if you're going through the worst day in your life. If somebody needs to be ministered to, man, toughen up a little bit. You know, we all need to toughen up, especially during these times. You know, there may only be a few of us in here tonight, you know, and I thank everybody that's come in here tonight. I believe there's a reason why you're here tonight. But, you know, we're going to be needed. You know, it's getting closer and closer and closer for the time that the Lord's going to come back. And things are going to get rough. I mean, look at Israel. Look at Iraq. Look at Syria. Look at the things that are going on with Russia and the Ukraine and so forth. Things are bubbling, folks. And we need to get ready and we need to get prepared. And we've got to be ready to do our work at a moment's notice. You know? And yeah, sometimes the ministering is tough. And sometimes it's easy, you know. And it's the thing with 9 of 9. We've had tough days. I mean, we've had days where we walked out and we're like, yep, there's 3 people here. And you know what? God always does the most incredible things when you have a few people sitting in front of you. We did that in November, twice in November. The first one was our third Friday Night Lights, and the only people that was there was Simon and his dad, Dell. Were you two there that night? And you two. And that was it. And you know what? We had an altar call that ran for about 50 minutes that night. It didn't stop. We didn't want to stop, and it was incredible. The same thing happened 2 weeks after that. We were in Durango, and we worked our tails off. I mean, everybody just poured out their hearts, and we sent out probably, I think it was 2,200 flyers. I contacted 15 churches. You know, they're saying, yeah, we'll get these handed out, da 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 da. And we had 15 people there after all that work. And I felt bad because Cynthia's favorite singer was down here in Farmington that same night, you know. And I just have to, you know, and I was brokenhearted. I really was. But there was a reason why we were there, you know. And I found out later, we couldn't see who was sitting in the crowd that night. But I heard later there was an Navajo gentleman that was there that I think it was your parents brought him up. Yeah, it was George and Angie Garcia brought a friend of theirs, and he drove up from the reservation somewhere deep in the reservation that night just to come up and see us play music and worship to him. And I heard the guy was sobbing the whole night. And God teaches us lessons like that, you know. And after that, I was like, okay, you know, Lord, I understand this now, you know. But I truly felt bad for Cynthia because, you know, she wanted to be ministered to by Jackie, which she was. We set a few real neat things up, and that'll be another day she can tell you about it. But, you know, that was one of those days that it was tough to minister to people. And there's been other days that have just been incredible that we've seen. So God will reward you. You know, you may not see the reward right now, but He rewards your ministry later on. You know, this year has been probably the most incredible year we've had so far in 2 years of ministry. I mean, we've the Christian Motorcycle Association asked us to go down to Truth or Consequences, and that was a different thing. I mean, yeah, we were out there. It was 100 degrees outside, but you know what? Man, those guys were cool. And we, during our warm-up set rehearsal, they gather up. You know, there's 50, 60 bikers that gather up and just started listening to us and worshiping while we were just doing rehearsal. And then the rest of them chimed in. Pastor Wayne was awesome, Wayne Vaughn. So, and then 2 weeks after that, we had the service in the park, which was incredible. And that this is why we do this. That night, we had a couple of gentlemen that come up and got prayed for, but there was one gentleman that was alone. I said, I've got to get off stage and talk to this man. And come to find out, he was actually over at a picnic over in the shelter next door, and he was just curious and come over to hear what the music about and what Pastor Travis was talking about. And the man gave his life to Christ that night. One guy. That's why we do this, you know. And every time we do, you know, when we get ready to have an event and minister to folks, we say, if there's one person here, that's the reason why we're doing this. So, you know, two are a bonus, and then after that is even more and more. So that's exactly what we do. Pastor, can you bring up on the overhead? Hopefully I don't get feedback here. I'll help you out. The bottom slide, that one there. There we go. Okay. And if you see there on that left-hand side, it says a conference. And this is what Nine of Nine is about. You know, a lot of people think we're a band. We have a band. It says a conference, and this is actually our vision. You get past a conference, it says, for intercession. Who knows what intercession is? Intercession is prayer. That is our very first and foremost thing we do. We pray. We pray like crazy. This is a very... this is a ministry that prays a ton. You know, we pray. If you've looked at our schedule, we have 4.5 hours of prayer scheduled during this conference. You know, whether it's one person, myself, or there's a gang of us, we sit down and pray for it. Tomorrow morning, we will be praying for an hour and a half just for people and churches in this community. That's our first thing. Second, after we pray, we're having our praise and worship music. That's the second thing that hits in line when we have an event, because that's the second group of people they're going to hear. They're going to be led into worship to lift up God and to move into the Holy Spirit to get ready to receive the word that's coming. The third thing is evangelism. And that's the third thing we do, what I'm doing right now. We're telling people about the good news of Jesus Christ. The most important thing that we do, you know, it's the Great Commission. Every single one of us sitting here is called to spread the word of Jesus Christ, to be bold and to tell people about the good news, about the ball. Tell them about the ball. It's all about the ball. You know, going and getting people curious. They're saying, I've seen you running with this ball. You know, why are you, you know, what's the deal with this ball you're running around with? That's when you get that door open and you say, check this ball out. You know, look what's on this thing. You know, this is what Jesus gave me this ball and he said to run with it. And he says, anybody who stops me and asks me about it, I'm supposed to tell them about this ball. Yeah, I'm using kind of a crazy analogy, but this is what it's about. It's about the ball. It's about running with the ball. Let's go to Hebrews. We're going to Hebrews 12. And I'm winding down here, so we've got maybe an hour, hour and a half left. Man, come on, people, wake up! Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm going to start in verse 1. And it says, God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers. Oops, I'm sorry. I'm in the wrong thing. My iPad is playing tricks on me. Sorry about that. We are in Hebrews 12. Sorry about that. This one's called The Race of Faith. It says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which is easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that is set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So we are asked, when we run the race, when we run with the ball, we run with joy, we run with happiness, we tell the world, say, man, check out the ball. And they say, well, what about this ball? I say, this ball saved my life. You know, my life was a wreck before I got this ball. And then I found out that Jesus paid the ultimate price. He handed me this ball, but before he handed the ball to me, he told me what it was all about. He said, I had to go and die for you. The things that you've done wrong, the sin that you've committed, I had to go up and I had to put myself on the cross. I had to take beatings on my back so you could get this ball and so you could have everlasting life. Amen. You had to take the ball. And you come to that person and you just say, I've got this ball. I want you to have the same ball. And you hand that ball off to them. And they take that ball. They accept the wonderful gift of salvation. They run and they give the ball to somebody else who has. So our job is just to keep giving that ball to one person. Tina gives a ball to him. Tina gives the ball to Rex. Rex gives it to Jan, to Sherry, to Chuck, to Linda, to Bob, to Simon, Luella, to Larry, to Jan, to Ron, I don't know this gentleman, to this gentleman, to Pearl, and so on throughout. This is what it's all about. Let's stand and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you so much, Lord, for giving us the ball, for paying the ultimate price, the sacrifice on the cross. And Father God, as you hand this ball to this ministry, Lord, we just ask that we're obedient souls. Lord, that our hearts are always in the right place, Lord God, that it's not about performances. It's not about getting our own names out there, Lord God, but the only name that they see is the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. And Lord, we ask that you just continue to work on each and every person, whatever ministry we operate in, Lord God, whether we're counselors or pastors, or intercessors, Father God, or are we work on a praise and worship team, Father God. Lord, just prepare our hearts to have pure and ready to do the work that you have us to do, Father God. We just thank you so much. Hallelujah. Lord, we just come to you, God. Lord, if there's those here tonight, Lord, that they've gotten to a place where maybe they're in a rut right now with their ministry, Father God. Father, we ask that you minister to them. I'm going to be up here for a while. Lord, you guys, let's do Revelation song, okay? So we'll do that. I'm going to stand up here. We've got Pastor Bob. We've got Chuck. If there's anybody, you know, if you're in a rut in your ministry walk or there's something going on, I'm just going to ask that you come up and ask for prayer. If there's anybody here, I'm not going to beat around the bush. If there's anybody here that hasn't accepted Christ as their Savior, if they don't have that relationship with them, I ask you to come forward. You know, I want to make sure that anybody who leaves this place knows where they're going when they die. So you need to ask that question. It's like, where am I going to go when I die? Do you know for sure? I want you to be sure of that. I want you to make sure that that somebody has been able to talk to you about getting the ball. Okay? So I'm going to give everybody a few minutes. We're not done yet. We're gonna do some more praise and worship before we conclude tonight. But I'm going to give everybody a few minutes to come forward for prayer. If you need prayer for anything, if you're going through some battles, some storms in your life, come forward. You know, I want to pray with you. This is what this ministry is about. It's about praying for people. So I'm just going to give you a few minutes, and then we'll step in and do some more praise and worship.
Marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy.
you tonight, Father. We worship you for it, Lord God. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a shout tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You are alive, Father God. You're not dead, Father. You are alive. We worship you, God. Hallelujah. Just worship him. Give him praise for all that he's done for you. Amen. He woke you up this morning. Aren't you feeling glad that he woke you up this morning? Amen. That you are breathing right now. That you are alive and you are well. Hallelujah. That's something to shout about. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
There is Jesus,
sing it with me.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, 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 break every chain.
Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. He's worthy, amen? Yes, he is. Hallelujah.
You guys ready to go home yet? I'm not ready to go. You guys want to do another? Hey, amen. Oh, what can we do? Yeah, the last call. Yeah. Let's do the last call. Because it is getting, this is the last call. Before we go, before we call it a night after the song, this will be our last one. I want everybody to remember Mesa View Baptist, they have blessed us with allowing us to use this facility. It is costing 9 of 9 ministries, nada, zero, nothing. If you all, in your hearts, I'd ask if you've got any extra cash to donate to them, a love gift. We've got a little box back there with praise and prayer requests. Just do what God leads you to do, and it will go directly to Pastor Tom. So, I mean, it's awesome that he's allowing us to use this. I mean, is this place cool or what? You know, look at that. This is for a lot of you who don't know, this is where Pat, this is Passion Play Ministries International Headquarters right here. So, and the Passion Play Four Corners practices here from January up through Easter. So, you know, this place actually has a very special place. You all right, Rex? Okay. Has a special place in my heart and a lot of people's hearts that are here. So, When we close tonight, Larison's not here tonight. Wayne, when we get done tonight, can you pray us out of this place? Thank you, sir.
can't calm down after that. Father, we just want to thank you tonight. Your mercy and your grace endure forever. Lord, thank you for pouring out tonight and just bringing us your word, Father God, and just letting your spirit just flow through this place. Keep everyone safe as they go tonight, and Father God, help us to remember the things we've heard and put it into practice. We'll give you the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen.